hating. Hating for no reason.
I love Eytan.
No reason. Thank you very much,
I would never do that,
Jeff.
Eytan.
You know, I had a whole segment ready for Jeff. Once a week, we dive into the weather. But that's out. Scrap that.
Let's get into this.
You know, I'm more than just a weather person. I'm
the
a human
Phillies
being.
The Phillies started their season premiere off right. 10-run game, and then more importantly, a win. So yesterday, the Phillies were back for round two with the Braves, and it was all about really that hit. Mm-hmm. They won the game, but that's what we were looking for, seeing Bryce Harper go deep. The Phillies will be taking on the Braves again, this time 7:05 this evening. Eytan Shander from 97.3, among other things, is here to break it down.
Yes,
so
sir.
Quickly, your new show starts tomorrow.
Yes, sir. Harry Mays, myself, 97.3. The app is very easy, 973ESPN.com/app. It's very easy to listen to. I'll be at Parks Casino noon to 2 on Monday.
All right, we can plugs.
All right.
Congratulations. All right. For the
you asked. You opened up
it
the door.
It was my bad. My
all
bad.
Right. Now you know.
Let's talk Phillies.
Yeah. Okay. Real quick, I didn't hear any boos on that home run last night, right?
No.
Okay, just checking.
No. And I think the boo thing, so quickly, people nonsense. Are talking about that Bryce
nonsense.
Harper was getting booed. That was really overblown.
Right.
There were like five dudes who were booing the pitcher throwing at him.
Correct.
Yeah, it was nonsense. But Braves are supposed to be good.
Supposed
so what
to
do you
be.
See so far?
I see that the Philadelphia Phillies have as much power and pop in their bats that we haven't seen since 2008, 2009. That they have the ability. Mikel Franco is going to be the best eight-hole hitter in baseball. At least in the National League. That's how deep this lineup has gotten. Andrew McCutchen, the most undervalued, under-discussed signing in the National League this offseason because he brings stability at the top of the lineup. Here's what I'll say. Last year, everybody had an issue with Gabe Kapler. Analytics this, you're crazy, you're doing all these things.
Yeah.
It was a direct result, Bill, of all of the changing of the lineup. If you add stability 1 through 8 in your lineup, you watch how good Gabe Kapler is going to look this year.
Let's see a couple of these guys. So I think we've got some of the highlights. You've got Gene Segura. He's one yep. of the new guys out there.
Right who at the is top of the lineup, up. Number right. 2 spot.
He's doing good stuff, and we'll see if we can get them up. So he's showed both his fielding as well as his ability to hit. Here he is. He's out there in the field. Look at that. The guy can field also, mm-hmm. turn in the double play, gets out of it. Then we've got. All right, so they took Nick Pivetta deep for a 2-run jack.
It's going to happen, okay?
Yeah, it happens.
Listen, outside of Aaron Nola and Jake Arrieta, it's going to happen. Guy's going to get taken deep. But you have the ability to outslug anybody in baseball at that ballpark. That's
and here
huge.
It is. You were talking about the bottom of the lineup.
Right.
We had Mikel Franco, who stepped up. He takes them deep. Like, we've been getting runs from the 6-7-8 already.
Think about this. You've got the best catcher in baseball, JT Realmuto, hitting 5. That sets the tone for the 6-7-8 guys. Franco was out of position last year. He was hitting at the top of the lineup, 3 at times. It was ridiculous. It's like starting TJ McConnell for 40 minutes a night. You just can't do that. It's no knock on TJ, but he's best coming in some similar backup roles. Franco is great in the 7-8 hole. And that's really where he's designed to be, in a power lineup. This kid has no pressure on him this year. And you watch, he's going to have a really big year.
So many highlights. So we've got
Harper,
JT Realmuto. Realmuto went deep. So all of the folks are showing their skills. Here he is, yeah. another new one,
yeah.
going deep.
I'm so thrilled that they got Realmuto because he can do anything.
Let's
he
look
can probably
at the highlight.
Host this show.
Harper. Was it Jesse Biddle he was facing?
Yes.
That he's local. Jesse Biddle was from Germantown Friends
That's
here
right. yeah.
In the area. So he got his first home run.
There you go. Welcome back, Jesse.
Off a local guy, right? They went on to win the game. They showed several skills. Now,
I
let's
can't
see
get
something.
Of Bryce Harper.
Do we have the Harper love? We have the Philly Fanatic. And let's see if he should continue to do this. So the Philly Fanatic came out, mm-hmm. wanted to show more of the Harper love. He's trying to rock the Bryce Harper sneakers.
I don't have a problem with that.
Is it a keeper?
I don't have a problem with that at all. What are those, size 30?
I bet you're good with it.
How big are those Fanatic shoes? I'm good with that because I think that the Fanatic is paying homage to Harper, who paid homage to the Fanatic with that T-shirt.
Couple things we got to cover quickly. Sixers, they came back. They showed their skills.
Yes.
Jimmy Butler gets booed going back to Minnesota.
I love it.
Mean anything? How you feel about
no,
the Sixers?
No, it doesn't mean anything except we've got the best villains in sports. We've got Jimmy on the road, we've got Bryce Harper on the road, and we've got Carson Wentz on the road. The Sixers are going to be fine come the playoffs based on how they've been shaping up the last couple of games. Yep. I feel better, and I feel better about Jimmy, too.
He's actually looking good. The NFL changes a rule. Okay, so we're focusing on pass interference. So you're going to be able to review this. It feels like you're going to have like 5-hour games.
No. That's a big misnomer here. The coaches are able to challenge. They don't get any more challenges. They still have two challenges.
Okay.
The only thing that really changes is while you can challenge a pass interference call, you can also challenge a no call. So the coach says, hey, wait a second. That was pass interference. It wasn't called. I'm going to throw a flag. Here's why this is huge. The Eagles probably benefit more than any team in the NFL because they have three guys that you can throw the football to consistently. Okay. Alshon Jeffrey, he's a very tough matchup because he's big and a lot of defenders try to knock him physically. That's going to result in a flag. Zach Ertz in the middle of the field, basically unguardable. So there's going to be a lot of linebackers and guys in the middle that are going to try to stop him. You're going to see a flag.
So it helps us. You're for it.
And we have DeSean Jackson back.
Right. And you got to hold him
to
stop him.
Just throw the football up to DeSean and watch what happens.
Wouldn't be Philly without a little controversy. So the Phillies tweaked their logo just a little bit. So you see that star on the top. Now the blue star has been there for a while.
Yes, it's been there.
But apparently when they have a new swipe at the stadium.
Right.
It focuses in on that star, and it looks like the Dallas Cowboys star.
It only looks like
fans were booing it.
It looks like the Dallas Cowboys star in your mind, and like 5,000 people's
minds. No, it looks like the Dallas Cowboys star.
This is the logo. It's been part of the logo since that logo started.
But when they do the swipe at the arena, they focus in just on the star, so that's all you see up on the screen is a big Dallas Cowboys star. Change it.
Wait. Why is it a Dallas Cowboys star and not a Philadelphia Phillies star?
Listen, when we stomp on it during the NFL season, it's a Cowboys star. It's the historic Cowboys star. Put a P up on the screen.
Listen,
lose the star.
Dallas does not live in my head. Do not let them live in your head, Bill.
Stomp on their stinking star.
Do not let them pay rent in your brain.
See, you can't disrespect me on my show.
Oh,
on Lauren's show. Always a pleasure. Eytan's new show starts tomorrow, guys. Make sure you are watching here, listening there as well. Hey, Sue.